Good morning. Welcome to worship. If you're not familiar with who I am, I'm Roger Kester. I'm filling in for Pastor Larry this morning. As far as any announcements, please note on the announcement sheet handed out today about All Saints Sunday. And then also next Sunday is confirmation at the 9:30 worship service. Are there any other announcements? Well, we will begin our worship service. I'll ask you to please stand. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, whose teaching is life, whose presence is sure, and whose love is endless. Amen. Let us confess our sins to the one who welcomes us with an open heart. God, our comforter, like lost sheep, we have gone astray. We gaze upon abundance and see scarcity. We turn our faces away from injustice and oppression. We exploit the earth with our apathy and greed. Free us from our sin, gracious God. Listen when we call out to you for help. Lead us by your love to love our neighbors as ourselves. Amen. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. By the gift of grace in Christ Jesus, God makes you righteous. Receive with glad hearts the forgiveness of all your sins. Amen. We continue with our gathering hymn, 772. The Lord be with you. Let us pray together. Eternal light, shine in our hearts. Eternal wisdom, scatter the darkness of our ignorance. Eternal compassion, have mercy on us. Turn us to seek your face and enable us to reflect your goodness. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Please be seated. We have special music.
The name of this prayer is called Misha Berach. It's a healing prayer that we do in our synagogue, in many of the Reform synagogues. It's actually done at every service, whether it's a Shabbat service on the Sabbath the High Holy Days, Bar and Bat Mitzvahs. It talks about the renewal of body and spirit, and there's a explanation in your bulletin about the transliteration of the Hebrew. The rabbi always talks about refuah shlema, which is the renewal of the body, the renewal of the spirit. And I want to thank Chris for writing a cello part.
Today's reading is Psalm 120. Those who sowed with tears will reap with songs of joy. When the Lord restored the fortunes of Zion, then were we like those who dream. Then was our mouth filled with laughter and our tongue with shouts of joy. Then they said among the nations, "The Lord has done great things for them. The Lord has done great things for us, and we are glad indeed. Restore our fortunes, O Lord, like the watercourses of the Negeb. Those who sowed with tears will reap with songs of joy. Those who go out weeping, carrying the seed, will come again with joy, shouldering their sheaves. This is the word of the Lord. Please stand.
The gospel reading this morning is from the gospel according to Mark, chapter 10, beginning at verse 46. Glory to you, O Lord. As Jesus and his disciples and a large crowd were leaving Jericho, Bartimaeus, son of Timaeus, a blind beggar, was sitting by the roadside. When he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to shout out and say, "Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me." Many sternly ordered him to be quiet, but he cried out even more loudly, "Son of David, have mercy on me." Jesus stood still and said, "Call him here." And they called the blind man, saying to him, "Take heart, get up, he is calling you." So throwing off his cloak, he sprang up and came to Jesus. Then Jesus said to him, "What do you want me to do for you?" The blind man said to him, "My teacher, let me see again." Jesus said to him, "Go, your faith has made you well." Immediately he regained his sight and followed him on the way. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Please be seated. When I started preparing for worship today, I read through the gospel message, and the first thought I had was, this is one of Jesus' healing miracles. It wouldn't surprise me if you had the same thought as you listened this morning. A blind man says to Jesus, "My teacher, let me see again." And Jesus replies, "Go, your faith has made you well." And immediately the man could see again. There's not much else that could be said. Jesus spoke, and the man regained sight. I would say that's a healing miracle. A couple days later, I saw an article in the Milwaukee Journal Sentinel that especially caught my attention because it used the word miraculous to describe what happened. The story was about a Waukesha man being able to attend a high school soccer game. And that doesn't sound like very much out of the ordinary. But 2 weeks before that, he had been at another high school soccer game where he suffered cardiac arrest. The newspaper article stated, "According to the Sudden Cardiac Arrest Foundation, Only about 10% of people who experience out-of-hospital cardiac arrests in the U.S. survive. Only 10%. Victims of sudden cardiac arrest only have a few minutes before death or permanent brain damage may occur. But what happened next was that someone called 911. Another person immediately offered to help and started CPR. And shortly after that, someone else came with an AED, an automated external defibrillator, which was kept at the school. And then an ambulance showed up and took the man to the hospital. I suspect the writer of the article viewed all of these pieces falling into place was rather miraculous, and especially with the man up and around attending a high school soccer game 2 weeks later. It wasn't just like Jesus' miracles, where Jesus speaks and someone is healed. But would you consider that a healing miracle? And as you think about that, I want to draw your attention back to the gospel reading. As you listen to the gospel reading this morning, did you notice that the healing miracle was in danger of never taking place? The blind man heard that Jesus was passing by, and he started shouting, "Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me." The Bible story says that many in the crowd ordered him to be quiet. A man crying out for help so he could be healed, and many not only wanting to ignore him, but telling him to be quiet. You know, why would people do that? One possibility was that those people classified him in a certain way. Mark describes the man as a blind beggar. Is that the way people saw him? A beggar? Someone not worthy of respect? Someone who should be out of sight, out of mind? Another possibility for the crowd telling him to be quiet was because he was calling Jesus Son of David. And we might ask, what's wrong with that? But we have to remember the context. Since David had been a king of Israel, and there was the thought by some in those days that a new king like David would arise, the phrase Son of David may have been seen as a highly charged political statement. And they wanted the man to be quiet. Another possibility for some folks telling the man to be quiet was simply he was intruding into their space. They were following Jesus. They wanted time with him. Don't bother us in our time slot. However, the man shouted even louder. Jesus heard him and told the crowd to have him come. And Jesus took the time to listen to the man and his request, and healing took place. So now, go back to the man from Waukesha. And there too, we had a crowd. And what did the crowd do? One called for help. One started CPR. One got an AED and knew how to use it. And, you know, these things may not seem so special to us. But I think back to, and I know this is a while ago, 50 years ago, I had a first aid course. And I remember learning something about stopping bleeding, dealing with broken bones, doing some mouth-to-mouth resuscitation. But I didn't learn CPR, and I didn't hear anything about AEDs, and there was no calling a 911 network on a cell phone at that time. And so this man experienced healing because people in a crowd had learned new things and they put them into practice. And people acted and worked together so that healing was accomplished. Can we term that a miracle of healing? Jesus healed people in what we think of as miraculous ways. But he also called people then and people today to follow him. And I believe to follow him is to have the same outlook of caring for one another and looking to help one another in whatever ways we are able. And I tend to think of that as a miracle, that like Jesus, people care about others, and we learn about ways to help bring healing. We will be continuing our worship service with the hymn of the day. The hymn at this point of the service often fits in with the theme of the scripture readings and the sermon. And in a way, it's our response to what we have heard. And I know, sitting in the congregation, that singing a hymn, we can't always concentrate on the words as we sing. So briefly, here are some thoughts to watch for as we sing the hymn. All five verses begin, "Let us build a house." The first time I sang this hymn, I thought of a church building, a congregation. But the more I sang the hymn, the more the words seemed to take on a broader meaning of house. Yes, a church building or congregation, but also a family home and the community in which we live and our country. And the house could even be our whole world. A house where love dwells for young and old, where we learn to forgive because the symbol of the cross reminds us of God's forgiveness and grace through Jesus. Where we share a meal together as a promise of that grace. Where we reach out to heal and strengthen, serve and teach, even to the outcast and strangers, knowing they are God's image. And as we sing that word outcast this morning, you might think blind beggar. And also a house where tears and laughter, prayers and songs are shared. Where all of this becomes a reality, is that perhaps a healing miracle? Amen. Let us stand and sing our hymn of the day, 641.
Let us build a house where love can dwell, and all can safely live. A place where saints and children tell our hearts learn to forgive. Built of hopes and dreams and visions, rock of faith and vault of grace. Hear the
We profess our faith together in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We continue with the prayers.
Set free from sin and death and nourished by the word of truth, we join in prayer for all of God's creation. Risen One, we give you thanks for congregations and ministries throughout the world that serve as centers of prayer and action. Empower missionaries, teachers, healers, evangelists, and all who are sent to share your song of joy. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Holy One, we give you thanks for generous land that produces abundant harvests. Strengthen and protect all soils, from rooftop gardens to prairie farmlands, to patio planters to fertile valleys, and bless all who lovingly tend them. Hear us, O God. Ruling One, we give you thanks for leaders of nations who work to build up the common good. Strengthen efforts of reconciliation among all nations, especially that peace extends in every direction. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Healing One, we give you thanks for all who labor for the health of others. Comfort and strengthen all who struggle with chronic pain. Send healing and relief to all who are sick or in need, especially Aaliyah, Paul, Judy, Larry, Tim, Joe, Jody, and those we name now in our hearts and on our lips. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Providing One, we give you thanks for all who provide for others. Inspire generosity in your people so that we may carry out the work of making disciples of all nations. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Living One, we give you thanks for the saints who have increased our faith. Give us courage to follow in hope until you gather us all around your table of abundance. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Confident that you hear us, O God, we boldly place our prayers into your hands through Jesus Christ, our truth and life. Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you.
And
please feel free to share peace with one another.
You may be seated. We continue with the Great Thanksgiving. Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread. He gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering his love for us on the way, at the table, and to the end, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We pray for the gift of your Spirit in our gathering, within this meal, among your people, throughout the world. Blessing, praise, and thanks to you, Holy God, through Christ Jesus, by your Spirit, in your church without end. Amen. Let us pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Christ has set the table with more than enough for all. The body and blood of Jesus Christ are given and shed for you. We share the meal. Please stand. Jesus, bread of life, we have received from your table more than we could ever ask. As you have nourished us in this meal, now strengthen us to love the world with your own life. In your name we pray. Amen. The blessing of God, who provides for us, leads feeds us and journeys with us, be upon you now and forever. Amen. Our sending hymn is 674.
Talents and tongues employ, reaching out with a shout of joy.
Okay.
Bread is broken, the wine is poured. Christ is spoken and seen and heard. Christ lives again, earth can breathe again. It's the word of our loaves abound.
Jesus lives again, earth can breathe again.
Pass the word of our loaves abound.
Christ is able to make us one. At the table he sets the tone, teaching people to live, to bless, love in word and in deed express. Jesus lives again, earth can breathe again. Pass the word around, flows abound. Jesus lives again, earth can breathe again. Pass the word around, loaves abound. Calls us in, sends us out, hearing food in a world of doubt. Gives us love to tell, bread to share, God Emmanuel everywhere. Jesus lives again, earth can breathe again. Pass the word around, loaves abound. Jesus lives again, earth can breathe again. Pass the word around, loaves abound.
Please be seated. We have an announcement.
Hi, I'm Rhonda Oystersek, and I'll be heading up the National Youth Gathering this year, or next year. 2022 for the kids to go to Minneapolis. Eligible students for this trip are going to be 8th graders through 12th grade, and we're going up to Minneapolis, 30,000 kids joining together in the stadium, learning about God, God's Word, and it's going to be an amazing time. So I'm super happy to say that we are kicking off our very first fundraiser for this trip, and it's gonna be Elegant Farmer Pies, ham and bread. So there's going to be a card box out in the gathering area. The information's on there. If you have not had an Elegant Farmer Pie, it is a piece of heaven. It is the best thing ever. So we're doing it so that it comes in just in time for Thanksgiving. So we're doing orders now through the 10th of November. And then the delivery date on it is going to be Tuesday the 23rd. And we're going to pick have you guys pick them up here at the church between 4 and 7 p.m. So you can order stuff for Thanksgiving. There's going to be a 3-pound ham. It's a cider-baked ham, if you're interested in that. It'll be $25. Everything else is $19. So there's, I got to put my glasses on. The pies are in a bag, so they're fantastic. A brown paper bag, you basically just put them in the oven, and they cook, and they smell amazing, and they taste amazing. So there's the apple pie, caramel apple pie, blueberry apple pie, cranberry walnut pie, there's a pumpkin pie, Door County cranberry crisp, and then there's two breads that you can get that'll both be in there. It'll be a pumpkin apple bread and a banana bread that'll both come for that $19. And then once again, the ham for $25, and it's a 3-pound ham. So please support us because we have a lot to do, and we're super excited about this trip. Any parents out there that are eligible, their children are eligible, letters will be going out early this week. So we're super excited. Please help us fundraise and get these kids to Minneapolis. Thanks.
Please stand. Go in peace. You are the body of Christ. Thanks be to God.